Yes, usually before I come up, I'll be quite, my heart will be pounding a lot. So the longer you do introduction, the longer it pounds. But once I'm up, I'm much better. A reminder that I'm actually here giving announcement. I remind myself that I'm giving announcements. It's like giving an announcement, but instead of church news, I'm giving the good news. Announcing the good news to all of you. Breathe, breathe. Holy Spirit, breathe. Jeremy needs to breathe also. Once again, welcome to our time for today. And I wanted to start off by asking you whether you did your homework. Because last week when I gave an announcement, I gave you some homework. And you know, that's the teacher thing. I was once a teacher and I gave you homework. But I realized if I ask you to raise your hands, if you did your homework, I need to do an altar call now for confession of sins. But this is what we're going to do. We're going to do something a little bit different today. Let me just screen this up. This is what we're going to do differently today. We're going to start off where you read 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1 to 13. So they take out your Bible now, whether it's electronic or not. Go to 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 1 to 13. Now, all of you who have a Wi-Fi, you should be able to access the Bible, whether it's through an app or through online. Those of you who don't have Wi-Fi, I'm sure you're seated next to someone, and you should have access to some sharing platforms for the Bible. If your neighbor cannot share Bible with you, I don't know what they can share with you. All right, so in this next 2 minutes, I want you to read this individually, silently, because I feel a lot of us have not spent time in quiet before the Lord. So I want us to do that. But I'll be playing some music in the meantime. So 2 minutes, read that. Why you ever chose me has always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other not quite, with all the never get it right. But it turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time, 'cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. When Moses had stage fright and David brought a rock to a sword fight, you picked 12 outsiders nobody would have chosen, and you changed the world. Well, the moral of the story is everybody's got a purpose. So when I hear that devil start talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? I say, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. For the world to see, nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. All right, that's 2 minutes. I don't know how fast you have read, but I'm glad that you did. And those of you who were on Mothership just now or in any other platform, come confess to Reverend Francis after this, yeah? Okay, I'm going to start off by talking a little bit about who I am, because this is my first time here on stage preaching a sermon. And I start off this introduction based on the song you heard just now by Casting Crowns. It says, I'm a nobody trying to tell everybody all about that somebody who saved my soul. Because ever since he rescued me, he gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. And I think that's the heart that we'll have today, that as I come here and speak, whether you hear jokes or seriousness or whatever, I hope that we direct us to God himself and his word. But of course, again, a very helpful background is that I have been, in that sense, I've been in two churches for extended periods, been in 8 schools for my entire life for different durations. Yes, including kindergarten. 2 different countries for extended durations and 7.5 years as a secondary school teacher. So what you're hearing is you're going to hear a lot of stories. And those stories may sound like you, but it's most likely not you, because I've encountered many different people in my life. And at the same time, sometimes you will hear things like, I'm going to give you homework. That's the teacher thing. Or if you're falling asleep, I may stare at you. But I cannot go down and knock your table. Well, this is where I'm coming from. And I hope that sets the background for today and the things I'm sharing. Today, we are starting off with this verse over here. Oh, before that. We're starting off with this verse over here. And this story actually looks like an abrupt start. He said, the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn? It's like starting out nowhere. Mourning? Was he mourning? Now you know he's mourning. He's mourning for Saul. It's like you're watching Star Wars, and instead of episode 1 to episode 9, it starts off with episode 4. And in this case, it is starting off with episode 4 over here, where you see the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn? And in fact, Samuel chapter 8 was probably the beginning. Here we see Israel saying, I want a king. I want a king. I don't want you anymore. I want a king. Can you give me a king? Other people got king. Why no king, huh? And God said, hey, I'm your king. You want or not? You don't want me, man? You want a human king? And they said, yes. Then the Lord answered them, fine. You want? You get. Don't say I never warned you, huh? And literally, you read in the passage there, he did warn. What happens if you have a king? And then God said, okay, since you want it, let me give it to you. He directed Samuel here, prophet. Samuel's a prophet here, who went and chose King Saul. Now, when Samuel appointed King Saul, he was so convinced even. He said, do you see the man that the Lord has chosen? There's no one like him among all the people. The guy is tall, I think taller than me, and seemed to have the qualities of a king. Samuel said that he was convinced that, sure, God didn't want it, but okay, we go with that. But then we realize that King Saul started well and then began to rebel and be rejected by God. And that's where we are here. The mourning. When you read this verse, I don't know what comes to your mind. Most of you will probably think, okay, somebody's not happy. But I noticed one thing. I noticed that God sees our mourning. You look at the passage, say, how long will you mourn? God notices you are mourning and he knows that you've been mourning for a while. God allowed that period of mourning for Samuel. But here, he asks, how long more? Because it's time to move on. Now, all of us here may have something that we're mourning about. You may be sad about something, a loss, a relationship, a financial situation, a family member. You've been mourning. And I believe as you read this, you can see God seeing that you're mourning. God sees you. Last week when we did the greeting, I said, I see you, I see you. God sees you. God sees your mourning. And perhaps today, he's asking some of you, how long are you going to mourn? How long will you mourn for Saul, the one that was lost? Then he says, fill your horn and be on your way. It sounds like God is that kind of boss that doesn't care. Like, hey, you cry so long for what? For to get to work. But that's not. If you read just the verse before verse 1, that means chapter 15, you see that God was mourning also. God regretted. God felt the things that Samuel has felt. So when God says, fill your horn, I'm sending you out, God is also saying, I mourn for this guy, yes, but now it's time to pick the next king. And imagine yourself in Samuel's situation. You've been losing something and you feel really, really sad about it. And God said, go to work. And he said, no, don't bother me. I'm mourning. If Samuel said that, he would not have been part of something great, choosing the greatest king of Israel. If Samuel stayed in his self-pity and mourning, he would not be a part of this. So we let that sing in. Samuel decided, God, you tell me, how? Maybe the period of mourning here has affected Samuel, because Samuel here is a lao jiao, which stands for someone who is senior, very experienced, and he knows his stuff. He's old in that sense, in a good way. He's old, and he's done so many. He has seen what Saul can do. And here, there's a moment of doubt that comes in, and he says, God, are you crazy? Are you crazy? He's probably singing, dumb ways to die, so many dumb ways to die. You want me to die by Saul's hand? How can I go? How can I go? And God says, chill, bro. I have given you a way out. Do this. Do all of this, and you'll be fine. Now, again, this is a reminder that sometimes when we see a difficult situation and feel the nudge from God, God says, go speak to that someone. You're like, how can I? He's so fierce. He's so unfriendly. If I go there, I'll feel hurt and stabbed, and I never want to go see anybody again. But God here says, I provide a way out for you also. I don't just see your mourning. I see your difficulty, and I can provide a way out. And this does not involve lying. He's not lying over here. So Samuel did what the Lord says. And when he arrived in Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when he met him. So you see Samuel trembling when he was asked to go. Now the elders of the town trembled. And he said, do you come in peace? He probably said, I come in pieces. Pieces of my mourning. But why did they tremble? We don't know. The Bible over here did not say. But probably because Samuel here, actually in the previous chapter, sentenced a king, an enemy king, to death. So they were worried that he would come to do something. So then we have, yes, I come in peace. I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourself and come to me. And then he consecrated Jesse and the sons and invited them to the sacrifice. This set the stage. And when they arrived, he said this. Pang gang lo. I finished my work. The guy is here. I'm done. Once I choose him, I can go home already. Woo, hallelujah. He said, surely the Lord's anointed stands here before the Lord. Now again, Samuel's an experienced guy. He should know how a leader looks like. That one look like leader. This one doesn't look like leader. That one, I think I lah. He said, surely he was very convinced. It's like the previous time when he saw King Saul and he said, there's no man like this guy. In the same way, here Eliab, he's saying, Eliab, surely the Lord's anointed stands here. The thing is, we have our own standards. All of us here have our own standards. And there's nothing wrong with that. We should have standards. Okay, we should have standards. You don't go and accept just anything. We should have standards. But at the same time, we realize that a lot of times we rely on our experience and our skills, our senses. Some of you have 5, some of you say you have 6. You rely on your senses and you have a criteria of what you see. If I want to pick someone among you to head the senior members ministry, will you go to a 14-year-old and say, I made you leader? All right, you have a certain standard. Okay, maybe someone who is a bit more mature, maybe understand the seniors more, maybe not a 14-year-old. You have a certain standard. Or how about you pick someone who's going to head the losing weight ministry? I am definitely not going to be part of it. you can't see it, the coat. Yeah. You have a standard. Now, if you're picking a king, you'll be thinking, maybe someone young, someone green, someone with 6-packs, someone big size. And you imagine, oh, it'd be this guy, except with more brains. So you see, you rely also on the here and the now. What you can see here and you can see now. And later you see when you the whole picking of David is just such bizarreness. You see, when you're having an interview, right? Some of you are in HR and all, you interview people. Hey, you want to work with me? And you interview. What can you interview? You can interview communication skills, yes. You can interview maybe some of the problem-solving skills. But it's not easy to interview heart. And even if you can ask certain questions that reveal certain heart, people will know that you are trying to test me, so I'm gonna answer in a way that you like. It's not easy to see heart. And here, God is literally saying, don't. Oh, that's the next part, actually. Don't look at the appearance. Although Samuel, Prophet Samuel, will say, I'm senior. I eat more salt than you eat rice. Here, we see God say, I created the salt and the rice. If we are choosing who we want, yes, you can use your criteria. But if you are representing God in choosing, you better use His criteria. If you want the Lord to be Lord over you all your life, then all your life choose the criteria of God. Basically, God is saying, there's no human way. You need to consider, don't look at appearance or the height. I'm like, I have my appearance height. And all the handsome people say, the Lord does not look at the things that people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. I remember one time when I was interviewing two Sec 1 girls, 13 years old. They were coming in to appeal for a CCA, because our CCA is a very hot CCA. A lot of people apply and they get rejected. So they were coming in to appeal. And I only have one slot left, but two of them here. So let me just call them Margaret and Rosie. But you can't know inside. Right, Margaret and Rosie. So I interviewed them individually. I said to Rosie, I only have one slot left. Can you tell me why I should choose you over your friend? Testing the heart. Rosie then said, my friend, this one lousy. She always like that. And badmouthed the friend. And I said, thank you very much. Now I know about your friend. Then I went to Margaret and asked the same thing. And Margaret replied, actually, I believe we are both good in our own ways. If she's better, pick her. I will gladly pass my slot to her. And that wowed me, a 13-year-old girl saying that, not being selfish. And this CCA slot means 2 to 4 years, you'll be in that CCA. It's not just okay, I pass this time, next year I try again. I mean, it can be a long-term thing. You are stuck there for a while. But she gladly says, If my friend's better, do it. The testing of the heart. I have another story. There's this story of another girl, also 13 years old, started off in my form class when I was teaching. And all the teachers who have a brief interaction with her would say, whoa, she's so lovable, always volunteering for things, always running around, and always wanting to take initiative and all. I'm like, ooh, great, happy for you. In that 4 years, it was the worst year of my life, worst 4 years. She created havoc everywhere. Sometimes looks can really be deceiving. There's one more story. This time of another boy, again in my class. So lucky. Huh? Another boy in my class. He's very mischievous and he's committed so many offences in the school. And one day, a classmate lost her ang pao money. So imagine you give ang pao, you got money. I don't know why she brings to school, huh? But she brought the money to school. And then she said, I lost it. A teacher's worst nightmare, because you're like, okay, so where do you lose it? And then you try to trace back and you realize that a lot of movement has taken place. Okay, anyway, we did a spot check. So we did a spot check and we searched everyone in the class. And one by one, those that have been searched, they can go. And we only left now with two boys. One is this guy who's mischievous. So these two boys, and then we came to him and we pressed in. Did you take the money? I mean, bearing in mind he's the mischievous guy, right? Do you take the money? And he burst out crying. He cried so bad. He looked at me and said, it's always my fault. Why wouldn't anyone believe me? And he dashed out of the classroom that we were in. I felt so guilty at that time. I judged him based on his past. And I felt so guilty for doing so. Have you ever felt unfairly treated before because of your past and all? I felt that I've done that to him. Until I realized he played me. He lied to me. Actually, he did steal the money. So he did steal the money. He was so good at lying that he could have been the first Asian actor to win the Oscar award. You see, I judged him by his acting. And he turned my emotions, and every part of my being, everything, everywhere, all at once. I don't know. I may not have eaten more salt than many of you, but I do have seen different types of humans, young, old, and the different things that come. I've seen the condition of the heart that comes. What is our condition of the heart? Now, what did God see that the rest could not? We have some clues in the next chapter, the next episode. I'll give you a spoiler. 1 Samuel 17, 28. Here, okay, before I show you that. Okay, so basically months later, Israel was forced to face that big giant. So you think Saul was tall, right? Saul was tall. Now we have Goliath, which is taller, right? And David was asked to go and become Foodpanda. Literally, he went to deliver food, all right? So Jesse said, hey, go and deliver food to your brothers and check on how they are. Okay, so he went to become Foodpanda, and then David was asking a question, hey, what is this about? And that's where the oldest brother, Eliab here, turned to him and said, why have you come down here? And with whom do you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? I know how conceited you are. I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. Talk about the pot calling the kettle black. It's English term. Jesus said this, before you think about taking the speck out of another person's eye, you have a plank in front of you. You have literally a plank in front of you. Take it out first. As we read this, as you look at your life, what is the plank in your life? I know all of us here have a heart and a standard, and in that sense, sometimes we do judge, myself included. But do we judge ourselves? Is there a plank that needs to be removed? Because now the irony is this. The one that the Lord say, I have rejected him, is now telling David, the one, the accepted one, I know how wicked your heart is. Whew. Once again, if you're choosing who you want, sure, go with your criteria. But if you want what God wants, use his criteria. And at the same time, I'm reminded this verse is not just talking about how you see other people, but also how you see yourself. Do you look at your appearance and say, no way I'm standing on stage. Have you seen how I talk? No way I'm going to be here. Have you seen how I am? I can't be in hospitality. I can't handle the serve the Lord. I can't preach. I can't this. I can't that. You look at your appearance. Or do you look at your heart? I'm reminded that we need to know how we see ourselves. Because you could be like Moses here. Again, God sees the heart of Moses, right? And he gave excuses. He gave this excuse. Who am I? What should I say to them? But if they don't believe me, then how? I'm slow of speech and slow of tongue. Send somebody else, please. They are more qualified than I am. What is your excuse? What is excuse? There's no monkey business here, literally. What is your excuse when God calls you to move? Now, I'm not talking about your friend who likes to arrow you to do things or answer questions during DG and stuff. But I'm talking about something bigger. What is your excuse when God calls you? And we believe that all of us here are called. You can't say, I'm here. My role here is to be a church member. The seat needs some warming. So if I don't come, it's not warm. No. All of us here are here for a reason. We are here to build up the body of Christ together. And if the body of Christ is only run by 20% of the people, what is the rest of the 80% doing? We are here. And God has called you. Yep. I hear loud. Yep. What are we doing here? And if you do not know, ask God, God, how can I build up the body of Christ together? And then we have this catwalk, literally catwalk, parade show where all these brothers start to walk past one by one. Okay, one by one. So you see, Samuel invited all the sons to come. He could have ended. He say, the Lord has not chosen these seven. I asked all of you to come, right? Are there any more? You see, Samuel could have said, seven is the perfect number. Seems like there's none here. Maybe I heard wrongly. Goodbye. Time to go. But no, he asked, are these all the sons that you have? You will see the importance of this soon. Because you realize, right, God could have said, go to this guy, find the youngest. He's with the Baba black sheep. He could have said that. But no, he said, invite the sons one by one. Why waste people's time? But again, we know God works in different ways. And if God asks you to do that, don't go there begrudgingly and say, oh, why? No, go and obey what God has said. And this is where Jesse said this. They're still the youngest, he's tending the sheep. And I'm like, they're still the youngest, he's tending. So he has work to do. The other seven, nothing to do, is it? That's why he come, right? So he has work to do here. They're tending the sheep, there's work to do here. And we wonder what went through Jesse's mind. If you are the father and someone important says, invite all your sons, I'm sure you invite everyone to come. Why leave someone out? Why leave someone out? So you wonder what goes through Jesse's mind. This is my wife's humor. So then Samuel said, send for him, we will not sit down. I don't know how long they were standing up, but they said, we will not sit down until he arrives. And then when he arrived, you see that he was glowing in health and had fine appearance and handsome features. All handsome people say, what do you say, amen? Amen. They ask you to say amen, right? Amen means you agree with this. You should say hallelujah, because now you... right, so he... You see that Eliab, this tells you Eliab wasn't rejected because he's handsome. So that's why handsome people, don't worry, you're not rejected because you're handsome. Because David here is still handsome. It says here, he's handsome. But God says, rise and anoint this one. There's a heart that the Lord sees. There's the heart that the Lord sees. And here we see Samuel took the horn, anointed him, where? In the presence of his brothers. One by one, they came for one. To see the younger brother being anointed. In the Old Testament, we see that when two or three are gathered, in that sense, it's important as witnesses. As witnesses, it lends credibility to a statement. Here we see more than two or three. The entire family, or rather brothers, father, prophet is there. But because this is a sacrifice, there are also the village elders who, I believe, they are around also. He was anointed and honored. But before you go, and like, think about a moment about David. He's not qualified. I say this again. David in Samuel 16, was probably 16 or less. Samuel 16, he was not qualified. I don't mean you can say the handsome look, but then he's not qualified. Why? He was anointed and given calling, but he was not ready. He has never fought in an army.
He is a shepherd boy, they call it. He can't fit into bronze armor, you see in chapter 17. Again, spoiler. He can't fit into the bronze armor and helmet. He's not used to the sword. He knows how to sing David had a little lamb. Say this again. He knows how to sing David had a little lamb. But he still doesn't know how to sing everywhere we go. People want to know. Those who have who've been in the army, you know this. He has never sang that. He has no experience. He went to a sword fight with what? Rocks. Literally rocks. It was so bad that Goliath looked at him and felt insulted. Imagine your challenge. I want to challenge the strongest among you. And then you give a boy. Boy with rocks. He felt so insulted. David wasn't qualified at this point. You see, that being called doesn't mean at that point you're qualified. You have achieved what you need to. But when God calls you and you answer that call, that will take you on a journey towards that calling. A journey, I repeat, a journey towards that calling. So if you are rejecting your calling based on who you are now, you are missing the point. I say this again, if you are rejecting your calling, God, you call me a worship leader, no way lah, now I cannot. Yes, David could not. But he was qualified by God. And it took him on a journey. It's not a tomorrow, today, anointed king, tomorrow, oh, hail the king. No. It took years. And years of what? You will read. Go home and read the homework, okay? Homework. Well, this one I won't chase. All right, go and read. Years of what? Years of blessings and honor and everyone shouting hooray. Some parts, yes. By many parts, a lot of running away, a lot of trials, a lot of molding of character, a lot of testing. Will you do the right thing or not? How about you? Are you going to answer the call that God has placed in your life? Or are you going to give the excuse of who you are now? Or are you going to look at what God has seen in you? Again, what did David have? David have this thing called the heart. Those with no heart, please stand. All have heart, huh? All have heart. David has this heart. And this heart is something that his brothers did not have. Not literally the beating one, right? What does your heart look like? Again, David is a shepherd boy. His heart isn't tested in the battlefield. His heart isn't tested as a head of department. His heart isn't tested in international relations. But the Bible says in Luke 16:10, he who's faithful with little is faithful with much. If God gave you the sheep, take care of it well. That's what David did in his position. And his position was so low that the father didn't even call him to come to the gathering. What is your low position or high position now? Whatever position you're in, where are you at now? Because when he's young, he cultivated his heart, his faith in God and the ability of God to protect him. I have conquered the lions and the bear. This is not a 20, 30-year-old conquering. This is someone who is most likely still a teenager saying, I conquered the lion and the bear. When one sheep goes away, I don't go call Papa, help me. I go, Papa, God, help me. This is God, and this is God to him. He has cultivated his heart to be God-fearing, God-loving, patient, humble, repentant when he does something wrong. You see it throughout his life, even when he makes mistakes. And I believe that's why the Bible recorded his mistakes, to show that even when we make mistakes, God can provide a way back for us. And I believe that is a message for all of us here today. Can I invite the worship team up? How many of you are actively cultivating your heart in your daily life, in your daily routines? Again, for David, he cultivated it not while he is in a prayer mountain somewhere, but he is in the mountain with the sheep. He cultivated it, although he may not have eaten much salt. He cultivated it in his daily routine. How many of us here are doing it? When you do the house chores, are you cultivating a heart of resentment? Why can't my wife do it? Or a heart of sacrifice? I do house chores, huh? Right, Elaine? When you are in times of stress, are you cultivating a heart of bitterness? Like, oh, my life is terrible. My life is terrible. Or a heart of surrender to God. You realize that there are many ways to respond to the same situation. But what you cultivate in your heart will grow. And if you really want bitterness to grow, throw some more seeds of bitterness. if you're arguing with your family members, are you guided by a heart of selfishness? I'm always right. They cannot prove me wrong. Or heart of love, a heart of unity, a heart of peace. In the office where you have an attractive colleague, are you intentionally trying to find opportunities to talk to her? But at home, you don't even talk to your wife. What are you cultivating? Every weekday night at 9:30 p.m. when the U.S. stock market opens and you see the thing jumps, are you cultivating fear and greed? Or are you cultivating a heart of trusting God? In your busyness at work, you can start playing something. In your busyness at work, are you intentionally protecting time for your family? Or do you have a belief, as long as I buy gifts for my children, they'll be all right? How about the unforgiveness you have towards someone who hurt you years ago? What are you doing about that? What are you cultivating in your heart? Cultivate here means to do what? To prepare and use the land for growing. This is the other definition, but I think it's apt here. To prepare and use the land for growing. In your life here, there are many, many, many pieces of land. You have the work land, the family land, maybe the church land. There are many different lands. But when you prepare the land, what are you preparing it for? Are you sowing seeds of lust, greed, unforgiveness, jealousy, pride? These are seeds. Throw it. And believe me, long enough, no matter how buried they are, they'll sprout. They'll grow. And when you see those weeds come in your life, you're like, oh man, why is my life so bad? Because you've sown that seed. Remove the seeds. Remove the plants of unforgiveness. Remove the plants of offense. Remove the plants that is choking you alive. Do you want to sow seeds of love, of joy, of peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control? Do you want to sow those seeds or not? And if your answer is yes, don't give an excuse, oh, once my circumstance is over, I will do it. No. You need to do it now, even when you don't feel like it. You plant the seeds. But I still don't see it. I still can't forgive that. Yes, you're right, because it's a seed. A seed takes time to grow. And in some of us, maybe it grows like a bean sprout. Very quick. But as quickly as it comes, as quickly as it goes. But some of us, it takes time and sowing and taking care and cultivating, preparing that land. How are you preparing the land in your heart? Last 2 points. Brothers and sisters, sometimes we are the stumbling block on why people don't receive Christ. They see our hearts displayed on our mouths and our hands. We fail both appearance and heart. Why would then they want to know who God is? Since you profess, you even put a Bible verse on your Instagram. Oh, God is good. And then in the office, you backstab people. And then they see you in your family and how you're treating your family members. They see both appearance and heart. That's not right. Brothers and sisters, I urge all of us here, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts. Today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your heart. Lay it before God. Each plot of land in your life, you can't have land of wonderful fruits here and one more land that's growing with bitterness, because eventually, things will start spreading and the weeds will grow. How are you cultivating your heart? With every eyes closed, we're going to pray. We are going to pray. Because God is knocking on the door of your heart today. Your transformation can begin today. It really doesn't matter how you were 1 minute ago. But today, you need to decide, yes, I will. And I want God to come. As we sing later, respond to God and allow Him to work in your life. But again, with your eyes closed, I'm going to first talk about those who have never heard Jesus or have not accepted Jesus in your life. I know this may be a foreign thing to you. You're like, why should I accept and all? But if God is placing in your heart a nudge to accept Him as Lord and Savior, God wants to come in. If you are that person, wants to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, would you raise your hands now? even those online, if you have raised your hands, contact us so that we know, so that we can follow up with you, because there's no point in raising your hands and after that disappearing for the next 20 years of your life. Help us to help you in growing. Let us know. One more time, anyone who wants to receive the Lord Jesus, please raise your hands. We're going to pray, and I'm going to pray assuming that someone has raised their hands, whether online or on site. Lord Jesus, we invite you into our hearts. We invite you to be Lord of our life. We invite you to take away all the desires and things that are not right. We want to cultivate a heart of surrender, a heart of transformation to you. Lord, we accept you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we sing this song, the altar is open. And specifically, the altar is open for these four groups. First, of course, if you have accepted Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Second, if for those who are still mourning, you can't let go of the past. It's just there. You're mourning, and although you hear God saying it's time to go, you're like, no. If that's you, come forward. Come forward. The third group of people is for those who have buried your calling. Someone said something about you. Say, I think you'll be in this industry. You're going to do this or that. And you're, no, not me, not me. You bury your calling. But God knocks again at your calling and says, I want to call it out again. Come forward. The last group is for those who want to repent and cultivate your heart. Repent and cultivate your heart. But even if you don't belong to any of these groups, you can still come up here. And as you come up to the altar, don't come up with an expectation that, oh, a pastor's going to pray for me, and I hope it's powerful. No, come up here with the expectation that, God, I am here. I'm building this altar here to you. I want you to speak to me. I want you to minister to me. I want you to transform me. Let this be a time between you and God. If someone prays for you, praise the Lord. But if someone did not, no one prayed for you, don't go back disappointed, oh, the human didn't pray for me. No, God is here. His Spirit is here. Learn to connect with Him and His Spirit. Let us sing the song. As the song begins, you can start coming up.